Hey students, in this video lecture we are going to see regarding the k-means algorithm and the illustrative example for the same. So in the previous video lecture we have seen the prototype based clustering, where these prototype based clusters are mainly based on the centroids defined for the continuous attributes, or the midoid defined for the categorical attributes. So these prototype based clustering techniques create one level of partitioning of the data objects. There are a number of such techniques to achieve that, but two of the most prominent are k-means and k-midoid. K-means defines a prototype in terms of a centroid, that is usually a mean of group of points, and is typically applied to objects in a continuous n-dimensional space. Whenever we illustrate, we use the two-dimensional space, but you can expand or extend it to the n-dimensional space also. K-midoid defines a prototype in terms of a midoid, which is the most representative point for a group of points and can be applied to a wide range of data, since it requires only a proximity measure for a pair of objects. So let us see the basic k-means algorithm. This k-means clustering techniques is very simple and extensively used, and it is used for the partitioning clustering. We know what do you mean by the partitioned clusters, where each of the points belong to a specific cluster. So that is the non-nested clusters are created. So what we do in this k-means clustering means, we first choose k initial centroids, where k is a user specified parameter, namely the number of clusters desired. It may be 5 clusters, 10 clusters, 15 clusters. So it is the user defined parameter based on the data points or the data objects which you are having. So each point is then assigned to the closest centroid, and each collection of points assigned to a centroid is a cluster. So the centroid of each cluster is then updated based on the points assigned to the cluster. We repeat the assignment and update the steps until no point changes clusters or until centroids remain the same. So we will illustrate this using a formal algorithm. The steps of the algorithm goes like this. That is, initially you select k points as initial centroids, then you repeat the following steps in a loop. What are those steps? You form the k clusters by assigning each point to its closest centroid. How do you decide which is the closest centroid? It is based on the proximity measure. Already we have seen the different proximity measures for calculating the distance. That is, it may be a Manhattan distance, Euclidean distance, Minkowski's distance. So using this formula, you compute the closest centroid and form the k clusters. Then you recompute the centroid of each cluster using these points again. Then you go on repeating this until the centroids do not change. So when the centroids do not change, then we can say that the algorithm has converged. There are some problems where the centroids won't converge at all. At that point, or in that case, what you have to do means, you have to define certain threshold and you should stop your algorithm. But if the points are naturally converging, then definitely the stopping point will come and the algorithm will converge. So these are the steps you have to do for a basic k-means algorithm. Initially select the k points as initial centroids, then repeating the steps, that is, forming the k clusters by assigning the points to a closest centroid, then recomputing the centroid of each cluster until centroids do not change. So what we will do means, we will be using the numericals as an example. We will see one problem, how to compute the centroids and how to update it so that you can clearly understand. Let us consider the illustrative example in which the data given regarding the students, the attributes are age and the marks in the three different tests are given over here for the 10 records. As the initial step for the k-means algorithm, we will be considering the k points as initial centroids. K will be is equal to 3. You can select 4, 5, 6. It depends upon your choice. We will use the Manhattan distance to compute the proximity of each point to the closest centroid. So, because Manhattan distance can be easily computed by taking the absolute difference between the two points for a particular attribute. So let us see that how to do to compute the difference between the centroid 1 and S1. You just take 18 minus 18 0, 73 minus 73 will be 0, plus 75 minus 75 plus 57 minus 57, which will be equal to 0. Similarly, you compute the distance of S1 from C2, that is 18 minus 18 is 0, plus 79 minus 73 is 6, plus 85 minus 75 means 10, this will be 16, 75 minus 57 means it is 18, 18 plus 16 will be 34. Similarly, you do compute the distance of S1 from C3. That is 23 minus 18, that will be equal to 5, plus 70 minus 73, which will be equal to 3 absolute value. Totally it will be 8. Then 70 minus 75, that is 5, 52 minus 57, 5. So totally 10. We are having the 8 over here. 8 plus 10 will be 18. So similarly, you can go on computing the distances of S2 from C1, C2, C3, S3 from C1, C2, C3. Similarly, for 10 records, you can do like that. Finally, what do you do means, see here, which is the closest centroid. Since it is 0, S1 is closer to the C1, so it will be assigned to C1. S2 will be assigned to C2, S3 will be assigned to C3. Here out of 42, 76, 36, 36 is the smallest distance, so S4 will be assigned to the C3. Here for the fifth record, out of 57, 23, 67, 23 is the smallest distance, so S5 will be assigned to C2. Similarly, you can make up the inference from this table and assign to the nearest cluster. So after the first iteration, actually we get the points assigned to the, or records assigned to the clusters like this. That is for the cluster 1, S1 and S2. For the second cluster, S2, S5, S6 and S10. For the cluster 3, S3, S4, S7 and S8. So now what we will do means, we will recompute the centroid for each of these clusters, k clusters. How we do that? You add up and take the mean of each of this. That is 18 plus 19 divided by 2, you do 18.5. Similarly for others, you can do. For the second cluster, you take the 4 points, recompute the centroid. Similarly for the third cluster, take the 4 points over there, which is having the 4 different features, then you recompute the centroid. Once the centroids are recomputed, you can go for the second iteration. For the second iteration, you write the recomputed centroids, again take the difference and assign it to the new nearest cluster. So till what point you have to do this? Till it converges or the centroid won't change. So this is how the k-means cluster can be computed using the 10 records. Next, what we will do means we will see one illustrative example theoretically for this particular k-means, and we will end this video lecture. So the operation of k-means is manually or theoretically illustrated in this particular example, where we are starting from the three centroids and final clusters are found in four assignment update states. So again, what we are doing means centroids at the start of the iteration is taken, then assignment of the points to those centroids. Here the centroids are indicated by the plus symbol. All points belonging to the same cluster have the same marker shape. So if you see here, the three plus symbols are there, that is the three initial centroids. Then in the second in iteration, these centroids will move further and it will separate a little bit. In the third iteration, furthermore proper centroids are there. In the final iteration, it will be properly fixed. So in the first step, points are assigned to the initial centroids, which are all in the larger group of points. In this example, mean is used as the centroid, how we have done in the earlier example. After points are assigned to a centroid, centroids are updated. The figure for each step stores the centroid at the beginning of the step and assignment of points to those centroids. In second step, the points are assigned to the updated centroids and the centroids are updated again. And in the second steps 2, 3 and 4, which are shown in the B, C and D of this figure, clearly shows how the centroids move to the two small group of points at the bottom of the figures. See, earlier in the beginning, these centroids were present in the larger group of points. As you went on computing or recomputing the centroids, centroids started to move towards the bottom, that is the smaller group of points, and finally at the end of the particular iteration, that is the iteration 4, it settled down or it got settled down at the bottom of this smaller group of points. Some algorithm may end up or like this in the 4 iteration, or for the sum data points you may need to go for the further calculations also. It all depends upon what type of data points or the data objects you are having. So based on that, the computation will happen. So for the sum combinations of proximity functions and the types of centroids, k-means always converges to a solution, that is k-means reaches a state in which no points are shifting from one cluster to another, hence the centroids don't change. For some, it may not converge. At that time, you may be required to fix some threshold and end the particular iteration of the algorithm. So this brings us to the end of basic k-means algorithm and illustration of that. In the further lectures, what we will do means we will see how do we assign the points to the closest centroids, how do we calculate the proximity measure, and centroids and objective functions. Regarding this, we will be seeing the particular lectures. Thank you.